Hello friends, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we'll be seeing the current affairs of Turn November 2018. We'll be covering these four articles for prelims. First one is based on INO, India Neutrino Observatory. Second one is about the Green Tribunal of India. Third one talks about National Board for Wildlife. And last article we'll be seeing about Partial Credit Enhancement Facility. The first article we'll be seeing is India-based Neutrino Observatory. So this INO has been in news for past 2 years. So for the prelims, we have to know what particle neutrinos are about. So this particle neutrinos were first proposed by Wolfgang Pauli in the year 1930. The neutrinos are elementary particles which are tiny and neutral and they interact with the matter via weak force. These neutrinos are also commonly referred to as ghost particles. And this is one of the 12 fundamental particles in the universe. They are chargeless, so they do not have any impact with the magnetic field. These neutrinos are created during both fission as well as fusion reaction. Some of the sources of the neutrinos include sun, stars, supernova, relic neutrinos, natural radioactivity, and even cosmic ray interactions. So these high energy neutrinos, though they are penetrative, they do not interact with any matter due to their weak force. So they pass through the sun, earth unhindered. So why do we have to study about neutrinos? Studying neutrinos will help us to understand the evolution of the universe through their gravitational effects. So it will also help us understand about the past universe like Big Bang theory, the star formations, and even supernova explosion. So India has proposed to build a neutrino observatory in a place called as West Bodhi Hills in Thani district of Tamil Nadu, which is now under the purview of National Green Tribunal. So the National Green Tribunal has stayed this project as this project is located in an ecologically sensitive area of Western Ghats. So this project is constructed as an underground facility, as only in the underground facility the weak force can be detected. And the neutrino observatory all around the world are located deep inside the Earth's surface. The next article we'll be seeing is about National Green Tribunal. So this National Green Tribunal was established in the year 2010 under National Green Tribunal Act. So this NGT was set up as a special tribunal to handle speedy disposal of cases pertaining to environment. So this NGT, it draws its inspiration from Article 21 of Indian Constitution, which makes right to clean environment as a fundamental rights to Indian citizens. So let's now see about the composition of National Green Tribunal. National Green Tribunal has its principal bench in New Delhi, and it also has four regional benches. With respect to composition of National Green Tribunal, so it is headed by a chairperson who is a retired judge of Supreme Court. It also has judicial members as well as expert members. The tribunal can have from minimum 10 to maximum 20 judicial members, and it can also have minimum 10 to 20 expert members. So let's see about the powers of the National Green Tribunal. So this Green Tribunal, it deals with cases related to seven acts. The seven acts include the Water Act of 1974, the Water Cess Act of 1977, the Forest Acts of 1980, the Air Pollution Act of 1981, the Environment Act of 1986, the Public Liability of Insurance Act of 1991, as well as the Biological Diversity Act 2002. However, one must note that this Green Tribunal does not take into consideration the cases related to Wildlife Protection Act. And this National Green Tribunal also does not cover a pre-independence Act of Indian Forest Act 1927. So it is also to note that this National Green Tribunal, it works under the principle of natural justice. So it's not bound by the Code of Civil Procedure 1908 as well as Evidence Act of 1872. The next topic we'll be seeing is about National Board for Wildlife. So we all know that India is a country which has very rich heritage of wildlife. So in order to curtail the rapid decline of the wildlife population in India, the government has constituted a special board in the year 1952, which was named as Indian Board for Wildlife. This board was chaired by Prime Minister of India. However, due to inefficient functioning of this board, an expert committee was set up to review this board, which in the year 1970 led to implementation of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So India became one of the early movers to enact a special constitutional provision for the safeguard of environment. The 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act specially had a provision for the safeguard of environment. And Article 51A of Indian Constitution, it talks about fundamental duties. Via this fundamental duty, every citizen of India has a responsibility to safeguard and protect the environment. The National Board for Wildlife is a statutory body which was established under Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So this body is an advisory body and it advises the central government on framing policies and taking measures for conservation of wildlife in India. So this body is the apex body to review all wildlife related matters and approve the projects which are surrounding the national parks as well as wildlife sanctuaries. We also have to know about the composition of National Board for Wildlife. So the National Board for Wildlife has one chairperson, which is Prime Minister of India, and it also has expert members. The body consists of 47 members, including members of parliament, eminent conservationists, government secretaries of various departments, chief of army staff, director general of forest, and other eminent members. So what are the functions of this body? So this body is primarily to promote the conservation and development of wildlife as well as forests. So it has power to review all wildlife related matters and also to approve projects in and around national parks and the wildlife sanctuaries. And no alteration of the boundaries of national park as well as wildlife sanctuaries can be done without the approval of the National Board for Wildlife. The next article we'll be seeing about partial credit enhancement. This article was taken from Hindu. So what is credit enhancement before getting into partial credit enhancement? So credit enhancement is a facility by which a company, it improves its debt or creditworthiness. So this partial credit enhancement facility was first brought in the year 2015 by RBI. So it was brought in to address the gap between the funds which were raised in using corporate bonds and the actual real-time requirements of the companies for various projects. This facility was introduced in 2015 for infrastructure companies to meet shortfall in the finance. And the RBI also fixed the enhancement at 20% of total corporate bond issue. And this facility can be used only by the companies for bonds with rating of BBB- or any higher ratings. So any corporate bond before issue will be rated by the credit rating agencies. So only the bonds which have a rating of BBB- or rating above BBB- can use this facility of partial credit enhancement according to 2015 policy of RBI. So the current news is this partial credit enhancement is also extended to non-banking financial companies as well as housing financial companies by RBI. So why did RBI bring in this measure? We all know that there is the non-banking financial companies as well as the housing financial companies, they are facing liquidity crunch. So this liquidity crunch is evident from the current crisis the NBFCs are facing in order to repay the commercial papers upon its maturity. And this is also one of the main reasons for tussle between RBI as well as the government. So the RBI has now expanded this partial credit enhancement facility to systematically important non-banking financial companies and HFCs. This decision was taken by RBI in order to solve this liquidity crisis faced by the non-banking financial companies. So the bonds which will be refinanced via this facility must not be less than 3 years. And in order to be eligible for refinancing, the bonds can only be backed by partial credit enhancement facility of this RBI. And the exposure of the bonds issued by the non-banking financial companies via this PCR facility should be restricted to 1% of the bank's capital funds available with them. The topics we'll be seeing for mains are how not to choose among allies, which deals with India and Iran relationship. The second topic deals with MSME sector of India. And the final article, it talks about the Sagarmala project in improving the trade across borders. The next article we'll be seeing is how not to choose among allies. This article was taken from the newspaper Hindu. So here the news is that India is one among the 8 countries that will receive special waiver from US sanctions in order to trade with Iran, especially with oil. So in this context, one has to know about the agreement which is called as Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action. So this is also called as Iran deal, which was signed between Iran as well as P5+1 in the year 2015. So it basically provided a roadmap for the nuclear stockpile elimination from the country of Iran. So according to, as per the provisions of this agreement, the IAEA, that is International Atomic Energy Agency, will have access to the nuclear stockpiles of Iran. And if Iran is not abiding to the provisions of this agreement, then the P5+1 countries are eligible to impose sanctions over Iran according to this treaty. However, US has walked out of this treaty in the year 2018, and this has caused tensions in rule-based international order. So in order to nullify the exit of US from this agreement, European Union as well as its allies are now working closely with Russia as well as China in order to devise a special agreement with respect to the payment mechanism to nullify the US exit. So now let's see what is the impact of this American sanctions plan on India. So the first impact is on oil import bill of India. India still meets 60% of its energy needs from non-renewable sources. And out of the 60%, 80% of the oil needs are via imports. And Iran is third largest importer of oil for India. It stands only after Iraq and Saudi Arabia. So American sanctions on India for the import of oil from Iran will definitely have an impact on oil import bill of India. The second one is about the investment India has already made in development of Chabahar port in Iran. So this Chabahar port will enhance the connectivity of India with Afghanistan as well as Central Asia. So because of this imposition of sanctions on India by US, there are no takers for the projects built by India in Chabahar port, which has led to investment losses to India. The third important impact for India is with respect to regional security. Imposition of sanctions by US on Iran will also make Iran move towards China and Russia, which can also become a geopolitical threat for India's security. And apart from this JCPOA, there's yet another agreement called as CARTSA of US. And India still continues to face imposition of sanctions under CARTSA, as CARTSA talk about imposition of sanctions on countries involving in trade with Iran, North Korea, and Russia. So on overall note, the American sanctions plan on India does not offer any sustainable long-term solution. So it is high time that Indian diplomacy chooses its allies carefully by balancing both the sides and without easing further tensions. The next article we'll be seeing is Historic Support and Outreach Initiative for Micro, Small and Medium Scale Enterprises in India. This article was taken from PIB. So as we all know, MSME sector is one of the important principal employment generator in India. There are almost 5 crores MSMEs operating in India, and it contributes about 30% of the total GDP of India. Its contribution to exports is also very significant. In the year 2016, it contributed almost 45% of the total exports from India, and 78% of the credit for the MSMEs, it comes from unorganized sector. Given this importance, the government has facilitated some of the key changes in improving the development of the micro, small and medium scale industry in India. So the first change brought in is to enable easy access of credit to MSME sector. So if the industry is registered under GST, then it can get loan up to 1 crore rupees just in 59 minutes. And out of this 1 crore rupees, and also 2% interest subvention is also offered to the MSME sector for all GST registered industries. And for companies which are having turnover of 500 crore or more, they are now compulsorily bought under a system called as TREDS, which is Trade Receivables E-Discounting System. So this is nothing but an institutional mechanism for financing trade receivables of the trade receivables for MSMEs from corporate buyers to 2 or more financiers. This will in turn enhance the credit availability to the MSMEs. So this mechanism was bought under by the guidelines of RBI. The second change brought in is to enhance the market access for the MSME sector. So the public sector companies, it procures goods for its functioning via GEM mechanism, that is government e-marketplace mechanism, from the MSME sector. So currently up to 20% of the procurement is made by the public sector companies, and this decision, it increases the procurement from current 20% to 25%. And out of the 25%, there is importance given to women entrepreneurs, and 3% of the procurement is reserved for women entrepreneurs. There is also enough steps taken to technology upgradation, and special technology incubation hubs will be set up across countries to improve the technology penetration with respect to MSME sector. The fourth area is about ease of doing business. India has seen considerable improvement in World Bank's ease of doing index, and it stands at a position of 77 in its 2019 ranking. And Government of India has adopted a cluster-based approach for developing pharmaceuticals-based MSME sector. And 70% of the cost of establishing pharmaceutical-based MSME sector will be borne by the union government according to this policy. The steps will also be taken to increase the technology penetration and implementation of computerized random allotment in order to increase the efficiency of the MSME sector. And there will also be an ordinance passed for simplifying the procedures under the Companies Act for increasing the efficiency of MSME sector. MSME sector forms one of the important part of the unorganized sector in India. And social security is one of the important area which must be given importance here. So the government, this mission which will be launched, will have Jan Dhan accounts, provident fund accounts and insurance facilities for the members employed in the MSME sector. The final article we'll be seeing is the role of Sagarmala in improving the trading across borders, which is manifested in World Bank's ease of doing business. So India's position with respect to trading across borders segment of ease of doing business has improved significantly. 92% of India's export-import trade by volume is handled by ports, and this enhances the importance of the Sagarmala projects in improving the trade connectivity of India. So what is the vision of Sagarmala? So Sagarmala is a project which is aimed to increase the port infrastructure The project also aims to reduce the logistic cost and time taken for the import-export of domestic cargo. So this not just reduces the time and money, but it also considerably reduces the carbon dioxide emissions, which is released during the movement of the domestic cargo. The project will also significantly help the Make in India initiative of India, as we are Make in India. As linking Make in India and port development will promote trade across borders. This initiative will also generate about 40 lakh both direct as well as indirect jobs, which will in turn help in harnessing the demographic dividend of India. And this project will also lead to coastal development as well as the skill development of the coastal community. Marine tourism as well as the fisheries sector are bound to develop because of implementation of this project. The Sagarmala project will improve the coastal connectivity of India, and some of the important ports in the western coast include Kandla, Mumbai, Marmargo, Mangalore as well as Kochi, and in the eastern coast Tuticorin, Chennai, Vishakhapatnam and Haldia. The government has introduced a few things like radio frequency identification, logistic data bank system, direct port delivery and direct port entry systems, drive-in through container scanners, as well as e-delivery orders, e-invoice and e-payments across major ports, which has led to a significant improvement in trading across borders. Thank you.